Harish Salve today in court seemed to suggest in one of his arguments that the residents of Gurgaon were being inconvenienced, that traffic was being halted, there were long traffic jams, and that was one of the concerns that was expressed by Mr. Salve, who's a counsel for the UP and Haryana governments. I want to understand from you, are the elite residents of Gurgaon, those who live in high-rise buildings, affected by the fact that you have farmers protesting in and around the national capital? Do you believe that the farmers have a legitimate right to protest on the highways?
Thank you, Radhik, for inviting me on the show. The truth is that only in the first three, four or five days when the agitation began, were there checks at the border. And it was not that the farmers were blocking the entry into Delhi. It was the police who had barricaded the borders, and they were checking or inspecting cars and letting them in one by one. I myself got stuck for maybe half an hour once when I was getting into Delhi, and we use two roads as Gurgaonites. We use the Mehrauli Gurgaon road, so that checkpoint is near the Arjungarh Air Force Station, or you can use the highway which leads to the airport and then gets into Delhi. So I was stuck only once. My wife was stuck perhaps for about 45 minutes. But
do you feel the farmers, do you feel, let's be honest, are urban upper class Indians willing to share the concerns of the farmers? I want an honest answer. Or is there a fundamental disconnect between the farmers or the so-called annadata out there and the urban upper class Indians living in their consumerist nirvana? Are they really concerned that farmers are in 4 degrees temperature through the night, through a winter nights? Really, honest answer.
No, we sure are concerned. We worry about them. We also think it's 3 and 4 degrees centigrade, and for them to be spending days and nights out there in the bitter cold is surely not easy. I'm sure all of us also have compassion and empathy for them, and we just hope that this gets resolved sooner rather than later.
Do they have a right to protest or not, in your view?
Absolutely, they have a right to protest if they have they have an issue at hand. And I think perhaps they should have been heard before these laws were passed and their views taken.
You know, it's coming down, Satyapal Jain. You're hearing where, you know, there is a lack of empathy, it seems. Today, Harish Salve was shooting off the backs of the residents of Gurgaon, suggesting they are inconvenienced. In Shaheen Bagh, again, the same thing was done. The government was shooting off the backs of the so-called middle-class citizenry that was affected by the fact that women were protesting all through last winter. At the end of the day, what stops the government from trying to negotiate, from reaching out, rather than sit on prestige? Why should every last winter Shaheen Bagh, this winter farmers? Something seems to be wrong with the negotiating capacity. That's why people are coming out and protesting.
I'll reply to the two points that have been raised by you and by my earlier participants.
Yes.
So far as the protest is concerned, if you recall, when they started the protest in Punjab, they were all sitting on the railway tracks. They were not allowing the trains to move. And it was with the intervention of the Punjab and Haryana High Court that ultimately they were persuaded, with the intervention of the Punjab CM also, that you withdraw your dharna from the railway tracks for about 1 month. The trains, both passenger as well as the railway train, the goods train could not move in the state of Punjab. And ultimately, when they realized that ultimately the people of Punjab are the victim of that, then the farmers agreed, the agitators agreed to lift their dharna from the railway tracks. And after about 2 months, the trains start plying both the goods as well as the passenger. So far as the negotiation part is concerned, with respect, I will submit, I have also been an agitationist during my university days, school days. This is perhaps the first agitation where the government of India has permitted 31 organizations, all of them, to participate in the discussion. When they demanded that 5 more persons should be added in the negotiating team, they were also allowed to join 6 meetings, 8 meetings with the ministers. Whatever the concerns they pointed out, the government of India sent them in writing that all the points that you have pointed out, we are ready to solve your concerns. But ultimately now they are showing you those cards, yes or no, yes or no. Do you think in any agitation, with any negotiation, is it possible to solve a problem by just yes and no?
you know,
the third reason is just one minute. Mm-hmm. The problem is that agitators and negotiators are two different things.
Mm-hmm.
The agitators are now negotiating. They are not authorized to take any decision because there are 30, 50 or 40,000 people sitting there. If you have to reach a consensus, you have to reach a compromise, ultimately, both these sides have to come to an amicable solution.
Let me take that forward. One thing more. No.
There is an important issue which is being raised.
Yes.
Will the laws be enacted or repealed on roads or they will be done in parliament? This is the another issue which is now coming. If you have a fundamental right, you have a fundamental duty also. You can't say my right to protest will surpass all rights of all the citizens of free movement, coming here, coming there, because my right is violated, so I will violate the rights of every other citizen of the country.
Let